There's the impression, again, and this is to you, Rachel, that mental illness is not expensive in any way, that really if you've got a bit of mental illness here or there, it's okay. I mean, what does it cost the world or the country or the family to have an individual suffer from mental illness?
I think it can cost a huge amount. It's a huge burden that often we're not really aware of. I think as well as for the person themselves and the internal suffering that they experience, there's an impact on the family caring for them. There's obviously the cost of the medicines, the cost of going to and from the healthcare facility. If the person who's ill is a parent, there can be an impact on the children. We know the children of depressed parents, for example, don't grow and develop so well. It has an impact on the child's physical and emotional development and sort of intellectual development, their schoolwork as well. Now that effect will go if the mother is treated, but if the mother is untreated and stays ill for a long period of time, it can be damaging for the child.
Is it true, Rachel, that new mums get depressed more often than the general population?
Absolutely, yes.
In other words, the child will suffer double jeopardy, in the sense that the mum will be depressed and the child will not grow. What are the evidences there?
The evidence about
the cost.
Yes. The cost. We know that if the person is ill, they may not be capable of working, or they may be at work but not working so well or so effectively, or they may be taking time off work. All of those things cost the economy. They also cost the family in terms of the increased poverty the family might suffer. We know that if somebody has a mental disorder of some kind, it can also affect their physical health. There seems to be an association.
Does it affect the country at all? I mean, what are the numbers?
Well, all those things add up to a major effect on the economy of the country. If one multiplies up the individual effect on each person, each family, and each workplace where the person is or isn't delivering, that can cost literally millions or billions for a national economy.
Max, tell us about mental illness in young people.
Well, it is common. This is very unfortunate because some people normally think that young people, particularly the adolescents, don't get mentally ill. But we know they do. Their presentation may be different from the presentation of the adults. But there's depression in childhood, depression in young people. And particularly during that period, they also have lots of other problems, problems of growing up, and problems of experimentation, which normally leads them into substance abuse.
In other words, a depressed boy,
yes,
can go and look for comfort,
exactly,
in alcohol, in banging,
exactly, can happen. So this does happen, and we have it comes in different ways, and I mean for parents, it will come probably from school. And in school, what will come is that this child who was a model child is now not behaving the way they used to behave. They start to do very odd things in school. And even more important, a child that the parents have invested in so much, they find that their school performance.
In other words, a child who's been performing well suddenly changes.
Exactly.
It's either because of depression, early onset of schizophrenia growing up. Rachel, tell us about women. What about women and mental health?
We think depression is caused by a balance between stressful factors and kind of supportive factors, with a small genetic component, but only small. So mostly we're thinking about life stresses and the supports that people have. And because of the roles women play in our society, and often multiple roles, we think they get exposed to more stresses in
life. Can you be more explicit, using simpler language? What do you mean multiple roles?
Well, women are often working to bring in some money or to grow the food. They're often looking after the children, getting the children to and from school, doing the family's laundry, cooking the meals, making sure that the husband is happy and supported in whatever he's doing. And it's too much. It's too much. Yes, it's an enormous amount to do.
Women
to keep the family afloat. Yes.
Women have more things to juggle. Yeah. What about biology? Yes. Having babies, monthly cycles, and that sort of thing.
Well, there's still controversy about this. There is some association of. Sometimes, you know, when women menstruate, they get mood swings. And at the time of the, there's argument about whether at the time of the menopause there's increased rates of depression. Mm-hmm. But an awful lot of researchers have hunted for the hormone, the female hormone that causes depression, mm-hmm. and they've never found it. So probably these associations for women, although the menstrual one is probably something to do with water retention or something at the time of menstruating, for the rest, it's probably more to do with the social pressures that are on them at the time of the menopause and so on, rather
depression
than
and so on.
Something biological.
Max, tell us about mental health and poverty.
These are vicious circle in the sense that if one is mentally ill, then they have an impact on the economy because they are less productive. Mm-hmm. And because they are less productive, what does happen is that their incomes are less. Mm-hmm. They are not even able to look after themselves. In places where medicines have to be bought, they are not able to buy their medicines, and then they become even more ill. So there is, the relationship is diverse. Mm-hmm. In many ways, and what if you look at the family, for example, then you find that the person who is mentally ill in that family is going to be dependent on that family for a much, much longer time, economically, emotionally, and so on. Mm-hmm. So there is it is a very diverse, a very multiple.
In other words, mental illness can be both a cause and a consequence of poverty.
It can.
Okay. What about urbanization, Rachel?
That's not easily answered because other things matter. If you're rich and in the country, then you're going to have less mental illness than somebody who's poor than in the city. If you're very poor and isolated in the country, then the isolation may contribute to mental illness. So, but by and large, the rates are higher in the cities.
In the cities.
Yes.
So really, and what factors do we associate with higher levels?
Disruption of family ties, being unemployed, having lack of education, being divorced or widowed, having lots of children, not having access to the money, not being the head of the household, being poor. But that's rich people can also get ill.
Max, you practice in this city for many years. What kind of diseases or illnesses are brought to you? Just give us a list quick.
Majority of it is anxiety and depression is very, very common. Then we have issues which are related to substance abuse. This is very, very common. We have issues that are related to the mood. People with depression, so we have a lot of them. And then we have people who have serious illnesses like schizophrenia. So these people will also be brought to us.
So it's a whole range of
from what we would call, for lack of what to say, from very major illnesses that the community does refer as madness, to conditions which are really of anxiety states which the community does not know. For example, panic attacks. Panic attack is a very disabling condition. It is here. We also have people with obsessive compulsive disorder. These are people who are just checking or washing because they believe they are dirty. They keep on washing, they keep on checking. Again, these ones are here, and most people don't even realize that these people are suffering from this problem.
From what Max is saying, it sounds like the whole world has a kind of mental illness of one sort or another. What do you respond to that?
I think we all have to cope with life's pressures, and we all try and gather our supports around us to cope with them. But as Max said earlier, we all have a vulnerability, and if the pressures get great enough, we might get ill. And so we all have that propensity and vulnerability.
Use simple words, potential.
Potential.
Is that what you mean?
Yes.
That a human being is but a human being.
Yes.
If you stress them enough.
Exactly.
If you put enough adversity.
Yes.
That's not an easy word, but nonetheless, I use it. Anybody can crumble into.
Yes.
Now, you're seeing this so much authority. Where else other than Kenya have you visited?
I do quite a lot of work also in other African countries like Tanzania, Zanzibar, Egypt, and elsewhere. I've been working in Pakistan, India, Georgia in the former Soviet Union, in Russia itself, as well as in more Western countries like Australia, New Zealand, Finland.
So you are an expert.
I know that mental illness happens everywhere.
Yes, okay. I'm going to ask Max to thank you for all the good work you're doing for us here in Kenya. Go on, thank Rachel.
Well, Professor Jenkins has been very useful to the development of mental health services in this country. In particular, we are very grateful that she has managed to get some funds to enable us to do some of those baseline studies that were being done in Chulaimbo, which are local studies to make us know the extent of various forms of mental illnesses in this country to enable us to plan our services in accordance with the nature of the problems. And for this, Rachel, we are very grateful.
Viewers, that's it. We've been talking to two experts, one local, one literally international. Now, if there's anything we've said here that you agree with, disagree with, would like to comment on, indeed, if there is anything you would like to say to fellow viewers, as you've always said, all you need to do is call us. We'll invite you to the studios, and as long as you speak frankly, you're most welcome. From all of us, a very good night.